Good morning. My name is Lily, and I have the privilege of reading God's Word this morning. My husband Igor and I, along with our two kids, have been a part of Anthem Church for the past 2.5 years now. I serve in our kids' ministry on the check-in team, and we lead a life group here in Federal Way. Life group has just been such a blessing to us. It's one of those things that we kind of avoided for the longest time, because I feel like we're always just too busy or didn't care to make the time, just excuses. But it was really just us not wanting to get out of our comfort zones. But it wasn't until we actually joined a life group that we realized what we were missing. Getting to know the people that we had been going to church with and diving into God's word together, praying together, sharing stories of our struggles and heartaches, and just getting to see God's amazing grace and redemption working in people's lives is just a testimony in and of itself. So if you are not in a life group, I would encourage you to check out the directory and get plugged in. This morning, I will be reading from Colossians 2:16 to 23. If you are able, please stand for the reading of God's word. Therefore, let no one pass judgment on you in questions of food and drink, or with regard to a festival or a new moon or a Sabbath. These are a shadow of the things to come, but the substance belongs to Christ. Let no one disqualify you, insisting on asceticism and worship of angels, going on in detail about visions, puffed up without reason by his sensuous mind, and not holding fast to the head, from whom the whole body, nourished and knit together through its joints and ligaments, grows with a growth that is from God. If with Christ you died to the elemental spirits of the world, why, as if we're still alive in this world, do you submit to regulations? Do not handle, do not stare, do not touch, or do not taste, referring to the things that all perish as they are used according to human precepts and teachings. These have indeed an appearance of wisdom in promoting self-made religion and asceticism and severity to the body, but they are of no value in stopping the indulgence of the flesh. This is the word of the Lord. Please remain standing for prayer.
Thank you. Church, let's pray. God, we thank you for your grace and your mercy in our life. God, thank you for Jesus, your son, who walked this world, who was killed and buried, but 3 days later resurrected for our sake. God, he defeated death, he defeated sin, and through our faith in him, we find a new life, an eternal life. God, I pray that you open our hearts up today. God, may we receive the word. May the Holy Spirit work in our hearts as we become more and more like Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Church, you guys can be seated. If you haven't already said hello, please say hello to each other. I'm just going to give you a quick shout out again to the Act Like Men Men's Retreat. It is always a wonderful time to spend together with fellow brothers in Christ, and it always reminds me of like camp growing up as a kid. You know, you go to camp, you come home, you got a black eye, something's broken, most of your clothes are torn up and destroyed. And actually, men's camp is very similar. Usually somebody gets hurt, your clothes kind of get destroyed a little bit, but it's always a great time. And spiritually, I always grow. In relationship, I always grow. It's hard to meet middle-aged men and become friends, and so this is a time where actually it works, and you meet other people, especially in your church, that are good dudes that you maybe didn't realize were great people, and so you strike up friendships. So I encourage you, if money's a thing, please come up to us. We can figure that out. The dates are, again, 16 through the 18th, Thursday through Saturday. I'm looking forward to it, and I'm looking forward to seeing you guys there. Speaking of camp, when I was 14, I went to youth camp, and this was, you know, I'd gone to teen camp, I'd gone to some of the other stuff, but this was like the call up to the big leagues. This was youth camp, right? This was 14 and up. And I was very excited, I was very nervous. I was looking forward to all the activities. I was looking forward to the speakers, to the worship, to the prayers, being with friends, tearing up my clothes, you know, getting a black eye, all of it. Like, the whole thing was going to be super fun. And it was. And the last night of camp, it was a Sunday evening. The preacher spoke, and of course, he took long, as they normally do, because we're all going to stay up all night anyway. And as he was speaking and as he finished his sermon, something in my heart changed. There was realization of you know, I'm a sinner, and how far short I fall of the standard that this preacher was speaking about. And so it really convicted me. I felt shame and guilt for who I was. And so in that prayer, I asked God for forgiveness, and I resolved to get better. I was going to try harder. So when I got home the next day, my mom, to her shock, saw me crack open the Bible and begin to read it. Now, there was no rhyme or reason to how I read the Bible. I just opened it. I didn't know what translation it was. I honestly don't remember even understanding what it is that I was reading. But I read it. And I wanted to finish that thing in 4 months. I started praying. And my prayers, I wasn't sure how to pray. So I would just stand on my knees and kind of repeat the same words over and over, right? Like, God, bless me, bless my family, sorry that I was so bad, please forgive me, help me have good dreams, not nightmares, the end, amen, right? And it kind of became what I said every single night, those just kind of repetitive prayer. I began to desire the gift of the Holy Spirit. Why? Because during the prayer at camp, I noticed many people were speaking in tongues, and it was something that I did not have. And so I began to ask God for that. I wanted to speak in tongues. I wanted to be like the others. And no matter how hard I tried to kickstart the engine of tongues, it just wouldn't start. It was like a cold engine, and it would sputter, 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 but it would never get going. It frustrated me. I really wanted the gift of speaking in tongues. I began to look at things in a very spiritual sense. Angels, demons, anything that was bad was a demon. Anything good was, you know, obviously an angel from God. Again, don't judge me on my theology. I was 14. And I also started giving up friends. Quit hanging out with certain people because, well, they're not Christian, right? Classmates at school, people I played sports with in the neighborhood, wasn't my thing anymore. I just was going to hang out with family and my church family because they're Christian. I gave up watching TV, playing Nintendo. I gave up listening to music. Didn't listen to Christian music when I was 14. I didn't find any bands that interested me, and so I just gave it all up because I can't listen to secular music. Tupac is not rhyming about Jesus. And so what I found was, after living this kind of Christian life, that I became very miserable. It was very rules, do's and don'ts, checklist-oriented Christian life. I wasn't enjoying friendship. I wasn't enjoying music, entertainment, because that wasn't godly. That wasn't holy. Everything was so spiritual to me that I was very discouraged that I couldn't speak in tongues, even though the Bible talks about many other gifts of the Holy Spirit. And my Bible reading and prayers, while they were happening, there was no depth to them. They were bringing no growth or use to me in my spiritual life. And it was kind of a miserable Christian life there for a while. I think I'm not the only one that's gone through that, or perhaps is currently going through that type of Christianity. And I think a lot of people don't understand what the Christian life is all about. We think that Christianity is about rules and regulations, that there's all these do's and don'ts. And this is what Paul is addressing with the Colossians. This is Paul's message, actually, for most of his ministry, if we look at the New Testament and read his writings. And so while many of us consider Christianity as a do and a don't, a checklist of things that we should do, Paul spent most of his adult life preaching and saying, no, Christianity is not about rules. It's about a relationship with Jesus. It's not about don'ts. It's about what Jesus has already done. You see, people are always tempted to substitute something for Jesus. There's something in the heart of man that rebels against the idea of living life with Jesus at the center of it all. We either think Jesus is the wrong solution, or we think Jesus is not enough of a solution, but inevitably what we end up putting is something else at the center of our life. But you see, what Paul's preaching, teaching, we're going to learn today, that there are no good substitutes for Christ. Everything that we need to live the Christian life is found in Jesus. The Colossians struggle with this in multiple different ways. We're going to look at three specific ways that are addressed in the text today. And I believe it's not just the Colossians that struggle with these things. And so I hope that we can kind of, united with the Colossians, learn some things from Paul. And we see Paul address three primary external additions, substitutions to the gospel that undermine a truly Jesus-centered identity. And he begins with what's called legalism. He says, don't let anyone judge you. Legalism, defined, is relying on religious rules for acceptance by God instead of what Jesus has already done for you at the cross. And the danger with legalism is that people judge each other over things that no longer even matter or apply. Paul says, don't let anyone judge you. You see, the rebukes targeting the Colossians were not about the gospel. The external pressures, the false teachers that were judging the Colossians, the church in Colossae, were not about the gospel. They were not about the divinity of Jesus. They were not about repentance and the importance of repentance or faith and how faith works. It was not about any core gospel issue. It was about rules and rituals. The Colossians were allowing false teachers to judge them, to intimidate them, to make them feel inferior because they were not observing the Jewish ceremonial law, the law that required them to eat kosher food, clean or unclean, the law that required them to keep certain Old Testament festivals, the law that required them to keep the Sabbath according to the law. And again, Paul spent most of his ministry combating this teaching, this law-based, rule-based teaching of salvation. You see, what Paul was preaching and what Jesus preached was that he had freed us from the power of the law to condemn, and Christ had fulfilled all aspects of the ceremonial law. Matthew chapter 5, verse 17 tells us, this is Jesus saying, I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. He says, listen, these rules, it's not that they're bad. It's just that they're no longer needed. They've served their purpose. I've fulfilled them. I've completed the mission. The power of the law has served its purpose, and now you cannot be judged by a law that no longer exists for you. And so what Paul says is, don't let someone question your spirituality on the basis of religious rules instead of Jesus. You see, legalism always tries to add to the work of Christ. For the legalist, Christ's work on the cross is never enough. So instead of faith in Christ alone, what the legalist preaches is faith in Christ plus certain rules and rituals and works. We see there's two examples given here of a special diet and the observance of special days. But again, Jesus taught the people that dietary laws no longer applied. Mark 7:15, NLT, Jesus is saying, it's not what goes into your body that defiles you. You are defiled by what comes from your heart. Exactly. It doesn't matter what you put in. If your heart is not changed, if your heart is not healthy, listen, you can eat all the sugar and the candy you want. Romans 14:17, Paul says, for the kingdom of God is not a matter of eating and drinking, but of righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. Again, it's about the heart. It's about the internal. There were these special days that the false teachers were observing and requiring the Colossians, the church in Colossae, to observe: Passover, first fruits, the Feast of Trumpets, the Day of Atonement, the Feast of Tabernacles. All these are found in Leviticus 23. And Paul is saying, listen, all that stuff is no longer needed. To the Corinthians, he writes that instead of focusing on religious festivals, let's focus on Jesus, who is our Passover bread. Instead of focusing on a special diet, focus on Jesus, who is the bread of life. See, there's nothing wrong with being on a diet or observing special days, but we must understand that these are not requirements for a life with Jesus. God was never pleased by religious rituals and never has been. What do I mean by that? He was not pleased when people brought sacrifices with their hearts far from him. God was not pleased when people would give publicly, donate, you know, whatever, thousands of denarii, and yet inside it wasn't from generosity or for caring for someone. It was because they were filled with pride. They wanted to show off. Imagine going to anniversary dinner with your spouse or, you know, boyfriend, girlfriend, or whatever, and they're just mean mugging you, and they're just not talking to you, and it's one word answers, and you're like, what is going on? This is our first time out in like 2 years. Why are you like this? And it's like, well, I actually don't want to be here. I got to be here. It's our anniversary. This is something we got to do for anniversaries. I'm going to spend whatever it is, $150 on our food, but I have no desire to be here. How would that make you feel? Like, this person is here. What are you so sad about? Well, they're not here. They're not present. Their heart's not in it. If somebody shows up to your birthday party, throws down their gift, and just sulks all day in the corner, like, what's that person's problem? Well, I'm here. I bought you a gift. Isn't this what you wanted? No, I wanted you to come and celebrate with me, right? It's about what's on the heart. And this is why God did not appreciate all these rules and rituals that people were doing, because while externally they were showing a love, internally their heart was far from him. And so a rules-based approach to religion is not something that God desires. And here's the thing, it's not just a thing of the past. It's still very common today, and it's very popular for several reasons, I think. I think it makes sense to people. We like checklists, we like to-do lists, we like achieving things. We like to have a simple and easy-to-understand list of what a good Christian should do. I think it's natural for us to feel that way. We love to make checklists and cross stuff out. My little daughter, a four-year-old, she goes to pre-K. The thing that she's excited about most to tell me when I pick her up from school is not her friends, it's not the wonderful snack I packed her or her teachers. It's about the stars that she got. Because if she gets 5 stars, her rocket ship goes into the purple area, which gets her a prize. If her rocket ship goes into the red area, she gets to talk to the principal. And so she's very enthused about the stars, more so than the purple area or the prize that she gets. Why? Because there's this feeling of accomplishment that she did something on her own to earn something. I think that's very lucrative for us. Something deep inside of us enjoys that we've done something and we've earned something. Our nature thinks that we can somehow make up for our sin, and so what we do is we think we can earn our salvations through these rules and rituals and laws. And that is pure pride speaking in that moment, because we want to rely on ourselves instead of Jesus. You see, and this mentality often creeps into the church. There are many unwritten and written rules in church that are actually not found in Scripture. And I'm going to just list a couple off for you. I'm not trying to create any division here, but just think about this. And think about other rules that you consider are church rules that actually, when we look at the Word of God, they're not found anywhere in Scripture. We talked about tithing. Many people believe that if you don't tithe, if you don't give, that you won't make it to the club. They won't be with Jesus one day. That's not true. Now, as Pastor Alex very well explained, we should have a spirit of generosity. We should give. It should be a natural thing that we do. It's something that we don't talk about often because as a congregation, we've always been that way. We've always been generous. We've always given. We haven't had to keep pounding this message of generosity, give, 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 because you guys are generous. Because you recognize that what Anthem Church has been called to do in the community needs financial support. Just talking very practically. And so if we don't give, if we are not generous, then the widows and the orphans do not get served by Anthem Church. The community of lost people don't get served. The lights aren't on, right? The AC doesn't work. So we give. We're generous. But is it a requirement to get into heaven? No. Is it a requirement to get into heaven to wear a suit and tie to church? Or ladies, you got to wear dresses? No. Is it a requirement to only read the King James Version and no other version of the Bible? No. Christians should not drink alcohol. Some people think that's a rule. real wine should be used for communion. Some people say, no, not real wine for communion. Some people say Christians should not watch movies. Some people say Christians should not dance. Some people say you should not have guitars or drums for worship. Some people say you should not read secular books or secular authors. Some people say Christmas is sacred and we should religiously observe it. Some people say Christmas is pagan and we should religiously avoid it. Some people say Easter's sacred. Some people say Easter's pagan. So back and forth, we see that there are these rules that we create that have no scriptural backing. Are these rules good? Are they bad? Listen, I'm not saying they're bad or good. But what these are conscience issues. They are preference issues. They are personal conviction issues. And the heart of our faith is not about these specific rules. It's not about rituals, laws, or rules. The heart of our faith is Jesus Christ. Now, these rules, these guidelines, they may be a means to an end, but they are not the end themselves. And that's what was happening in the church of Colossae, is these rules had taken precedent over Jesus, who was the one that had saved them. Paul says that these rules, these laws, are a shadow. That's the problem with this thing, is it's a shadow of the things to come. The substance belongs to Christ in verse 17. Hebrews 10:1 tells, the author says, for since the law has but a shadow of the good things to come instead of the true form of these realities. Here's what that means. Imagine preferring the smell of a steak over actually biting into it right in front of you. Imagine preferring a picture of the sunset instead of stepping outside and enjoying the dang thing in person. My wife was gone for 5 days, 4 nights, and it was tough. The kids and I missed her. I have a newfound respect for her. I go away for 2 days every week, and I don't know how she's done it for 17 years. I barely made it through 4, you know, days. House was hanging on by a thread. And so when she came home, she flew in late. My kids were in bed, and I decided to stay up for her because, well, I missed her. And her mom brought her home, and she walked in, and our foyer has the lights, the chandelier thing, and it's shining the light on her, and her shadow is reflected on the wall behind her. Now, it would be very weird and awkward of me to come running past my wife and go to the shadow and start interacting and trying to hug and pet and, you know, and see if things are great with her. That would not work. That would make no sense. Why? Because the real thing is right there. The shadow has no reality to it. The real thing is right here, standing at my doorstep, waiting to be hugged and kissed. A shadow has no reality in it and of itself. It only points out the reality of something else. And in the same way, the things pertaining to the Old Testament ceremonial law, these rules and rituals, had no substance in themselves, but only as they related and pointed to the coming of Jesus Christ. So what is the solution for legalism? It is to focus on the reality which is found in Jesus, not rule or ritual. Paul says all these things were shadows pointing to the fulfillment of the reality which is found in Christ. And just as a shadow is completely dependent on the real object, the law is absolutely dependent on Jesus. A shadow is temporary, but the reality is permanent. A shadow is a poor substitute for the real thing. So how do we fight legalism? We focus on the reality which is found in Jesus. The other thing that the Colossians were struggling with and there was pressure on about was mysticism, this idea of mysticism. And mysticism is the pursuit of a deeper religious experience. It is the practice of experiential knowledge of God. In other words, it's very experience / emotion driven versus truth driven. Paul says, let no one disqualify you, insisting on asceticism, which we'll talk about here in a second. Worship of angels, going on in detail about visions, puffed up without reason by his sensuous mind. So if legalism is relying on religious rules for acceptance by God instead of what Christ has done for you at the cross, a mysticism is relying on religious experience for status within the church. The danger with mysticism is that people will disqualify you or each other depending on whether or not they've had a certain specific type of experience, religious experience. Disqualify has this connotation or meaning of to decide against someone or to give judgment against someone. It actually has roots in the Greek word for umpire. So what these false teachers were doing was they were self-appointed spiritual referees who were disqualifying the Colossians because they did not have certain religious experiences. Just like an umpire would call you out or a referee would eject you from the game, that's what these false teachers were doing. They were judging others and saying, you did not have this experience like I did. You're not seeing angels. You're not seeing this. You're out. You don't belong. You don't qualify. And so people who rely on religious experience often display a false sense of humility, which is really just pride in disguise. That's what Paul says. He says they are puffed up with idle notions by their unspiritual mind. Now, the irony here is they thought that they were being so spiritual when Paul says they're not spiritual at all because they're not filled with the Spirit, they're filled with pride. Now, again, there's nothing wrong with religious experience, spiritual experiences in and of itself. Just as there's nothing wrong with having guidelines and discipline in our faith. It's wrong when we compare, when we try to make our experience the standard for someone else's spirituality. Do you understand what I'm saying? When we begin to judge others, how that person prays, or are they speaking in tongues? Are they prophesying? Are they looking the right way? Do they have their hands folded, their eyes closed? Are they somber or are they happy? Are they like me when they pray? Because if they're not, then they're not qualified. They're not worshiping correctly. There's too much going on here, too much clapping, too much yelling. That's not right. This is the house of God. Or that person is just standing there. They should be jumping for joy because Jesus has saved us. When we begin to judge other people on the basis of our own personal religious experience, we are in sin and we have pride. When we look at other people's giftings of the Holy Spirit and we say, well, that guy doesn't have what I got. Or this church is quiet in their communal prayers. This does not qualify in God's eyes. Listen, you are filled with pride, my man. Oh, bye. Life at the monastery, he comes and he gets his 2 words total. And the we should and carry it daily. There are things that need to change. There are things that need to leave our life that should not be in our sphere so that we may honor and glorify God. Yes, 100%. But where we get into trouble is when we begin to go to the extreme of this, and we begin to decline or deprive of us, and somehow, because of that act of deprivation, we think we are earning God's grace and mercy and forgiveness. 1 Timothy, Paul is writing to Timothy, he says, our hope should be on God, who richly provides us with everything to enjoy. Some people think that these superhuman feats of self-denial must be super spiritual, but there is no real wisdom in asceticism. It's a hard one to pronounce. God says in Isaiah 29:13, NIV, these people come near to me with their mouth and honor me with their lips. But what? But their hearts are far from me. We're talking about the people that are legalistic. We're talking about the people that have these spiritual experiences, that they place more emphasis on the experience than what Jesus did on the cross. We're talking about people that do these self-denial feats that are really not required, but they feel puffed up in what they've done. And so we come before God and we say, God, look at all this. I love you. And God says, but your heart is not in it. Their worship of me, Isaiah says, is based on merely human rules they have been taught. The answer is not more legalism in the church. The answer is not more mysticism. The answer is not more self-denial, extreme self-denial. The answer is always simply faith in Christ and Christ alone, who died for us and forgave our sins. He did the work. He was the sacrifice. And when we believe in him, when we place our faith in him, we inherit that. We are dead to our old self, and we are born into a new life. We are disciples of his. We follow Jesus. Perhaps not in person, but we have the helper, the Holy Spirit, living in us that is always present. I want to conclude with these final words. People are always going to be tempted to substitute for Jesus, but there are no good substitutes. Jesus is everything we need to live the Christian life. The Christian life, again, is not about religious rules, although there's nothing wrong with order. There's nothing wrong with seeking spiritual experience. In fact, we should experience it. If we believe that the Holy Spirit lives in us, if he is evident and present in us, we should see evidence of that. We should give some things up in our life. We should have a new will, a new way. Imagine if you just decided to run a marathon right now. Like right out the door, we've got the marathon going on, and you're like, I'm just going to go out and do it. And I say, hey, if you win, I'm going to give you $1,000. Perhaps your first inclination would be, oh, $1,000. In this economy, that's up it up to 10, and I'll do it. You would perhaps think, well, it's been a while since I've done any running, you know, maybe a little out of shape. But then you're like, but it's 10, it's good money. I can do it. I'm going to try. I try really hard. And here's the reality. And maybe I'm just speaking for myself because obviously I'm not a runner. If I tried to run a marathon right now, I don't think I'd make it. Maybe on sheer willpower alone, I'd stumble across the finish line after everybody had been done and had showered up and gone home. Perhaps. But it would not be a very successful run. Why? Because I don't run a lot. Basketball, yes. Long distances, no. Not built for that. God did not create me to be a long-distance runner. And so no matter how hard I would try to compete in marathons, to get the bronze, the silver, or the gold, I don't think I would do well just by trying. But if I was really serious about winning a marathon or even just completing one, what I would need to do is to transform my life around the goal of finishing or winning a marathon. I would have to make my whole life about training for this one event. Everything in my life would have to be focused on this one goal to win or to at least finish a marathon. Trying would not be good enough. I would have to train. I would have to put in effort. I would have to practice. And you see, our spiritual life is the same way. Oftentimes, I would hear a sermon on Sunday, and I would say, wow, that spoke to me. Tomorrow, things will be different. Tomorrow, I'm going to try harder. Tomorrow, things are going to change wholesale. And the reality is, no matter how hard I would try, I would ultimately fail. It may persist for a while, but ultimately it would fail. Because it's not about trying. It's about creating an atmosphere, a lifestyle of training towards a certain goal. There's a huge difference between training to do something and trying to do something. There is. Spiritual transformation is not a matter of trying harder, implementing more rules, having more experiences, removing even more stuff from your life. That's you're trying, but it's not going to lead to anything. What you have to do is to train wisely. This is what the Apostle Paul means when he encourages his young protege Timothy to train yourself in godliness. This is the thought that lies behind his words when he speaks to the Corinthian church. And he says, everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training. They do it to get a crown that will not last, but we do it to get a crown that will last forever. He says there's a way that we live our life. There's certain things that we implement in our life that it's not about trying. It's about training ourselves to be like Jesus. It's not just applying to learning a musical instrument or running a marathon. It applies to living a healthy, vibrant spiritual life. John Ortberg, in The Life You've Always Wanted, he says these words. He says, following Jesus simply means learning from him how to arrange my life around activities that enable me to live in the fruit of the Spirit. So practically speaking, I have a few things we can implement into our life that is not about trying hard, but training ourselves to be a disciple of Jesus. We can practice rest in a culture of hurry and exhaustion through the practice of Sabbath. We can practice peace and quiet in a culture of anxiety and noise with the practice of solitude. We can practice communion with God in a culture of distraction and escapism through the practice of prayer. Practice love and depth in a culture of individualism and superficiality through the practice of community. We can practice courageous fidelity to orthodoxy in a culture of ideological compromise through the practice of reading scripture. We can practice holiness in a culture of indulgence and immorality through the practice of fasting. We can practice contentment in a culture of consumerism through the practice of generosity. We can practice justice, mercy, and reconciliation in a culture of injustice and division through the practice of service. We can practice hospitality in a culture of hostility through the practice of witness. Listen, as a Christian, we have already received fullness and freedom in Jesus Christ. We cannot add or subtract from anything that Jesus has already done for us. And so true spirituality is not a matter of rules or experiences or religious acts, but it is a relationship with Jesus Christ. And we can build our life in such a way that we can train in a healthy way. Not our external, but our internal, our hearts, our character, to be like Christ. Church, if you guys could rise, let's finish in prayer. Anthem Church, I just encourage you. When you leave church today, tomorrow, trying harder is not going to help. It's looking wholesale at who you are. Is Jesus number one in your life? Has Jesus begun to transform your heart? And if not, allow the Holy Spirit, allow Jesus to be the only thing that dictates what your Christian life looks like. God, we thank you for the opportunity to gather. God, we thank you for your word, for your grace, and your mercy. Lord, I pray that as Anthem Church, that we become more and more like you. God, that we call ourselves disciples of Jesus, Lord, that with that name, Christian or disciple, Lord, that we take it seriously, Lord, that we begin to recognize areas that of our life that are not like you, God, and begin to change and train those areas. Lord, may we not be taken away or swept up by legalism, mysticism, self-denial, God. I pray, Lord, that these things do not overtake that which is primary, which is Jesus Christ. Thank you, God. Bless us. Give us your grace for the rest of this week, and in your name I pray, amen.
Pastor, that was a good sermon, is what I often hear after a sermon. And my response is, brother, we'll tell from a week from today if it was a good sermon. And that's what Jesus taught. If you remember his parable on the four soils, right, where the seed, the word, the sermon was spread everywhere. Everybody got to hear it. And only the good soil produced fruit. And so we could preach all we want. We can have long sermons. We can have short sermons. At the end of the day, what matters is how we receive the word, And the way we determine if we received a word is, does it move us? Right? Does it practically change us? Does it transform us? Is there fruit, practical fruit, evidence in our life that we received a good sermon on Sunday? And so, have you received a sermon? Has this sermon touched your heart? Like, has it touched your heart? Has it touched my heart? And the heart, we know when we say the heart, we're talking about the will. Like, the area that actually makes decisions in life. And so I just want to take a moment now and receive the sermon. Not just to walk away, not just to hurry, because what's the point of even gathering for an hour and 15 minutes if we're going to walk away utterly unchanged? If we just got inspired in our head. And we like that quote, or we like that joke. We need to be transformed. Don't just be hearers of God's word, be doers of it. So let's just take a moment and receive this word. This is this is the most sacred moment of this gathering. What will you do with today's word? The Holy Spirit has spoken to you during the preaching. Would you just stretch out your hands as a posture of, Lord, I have received. I hear you. If you have been convicted and you need to repent, stretch out your hands and say, Lord, I surrender. I release these things in my life, Lord. I lay them at your feet. I want to walk away from this lifestyle. Whatever that is, just take this time to respond. Embody your conviction. If you would like to come up and talk to a pastor, maybe you want to confess your sins, confess what's going on in your life. The idea of confession is not just saying you're sorry, but it's prosecuting yourself. It's exposing all the inner intentions, the motives that are usually never revealed in confessions. Maybe you're just going through a hard season. You need support, prayer, whatever the Holy Spirit is prompting you to, would you consider responding? Father, we thank you. Lord, we love you. We bless you. God, we desire to be your church, to be rooted in Christ and Christ alone, and no other foundation will we build our lives on, God. We will not build our lives on tradition. We will not build our lives on our willpower. We will not build our lives on experience. Father, we will build our life on your word alone. And all God's people said, amen. Let it be so. Come on, God is good. Hey, thank you so much for coming out. This is truly a delight for myself. God bless you. We have some coffee out in the foyer just to make our fellowship a little bit more sweet.